Are you new to OBS and possibly wondering, what is going on with the layouts? What are all these settings? And how do I optimize this program to run the best that it can for recording or streaming or whichever purpose you plan on using it for? Or maybe you are somewhat used to using OBS and you just want to know what some other features are, or maybe some better practices for setting up scenes and recording and streaming as well. If so, stay tuned, because this video is a ultimate beginner's guide and we're going to cover pretty much everything in this video. What's going on, guys? Chad here from How To Tech, the channel dedicated to helping you take your tech to the next level. And this is the ultimate OBS beginner's guide. This is great if you are just getting started using the program, or if you've been using it for a little while and want to know what certain settings are or how to better use the program. So without further ado, we're going to go ahead and play a small little clip that will show you the different timestamps for the information that we cover in certain sections. And feel free to check the description out as well for the timestamps to jump around to whatever parts of the videos that this video that you find interesting for yourself. So without further ado, let's go ahead and jump into it. All right, guys, so getting started with basic OBS information, and that is, you know, what version and iteration of OBS we're using. So we're using vanilla OBS version 25.0.8. There are obviously other version numbers of vanilla OBS, and there's also different iterations such as Streamlabs OBS and Stream Elements OBS. Pretty much they're fairly similar, and the settings that we're going to be covering today are pretty much identical throughout those. They might just look slightly different, or maybe referenced in a slightly different way. But for the most part, everything that you learn here should apply and cross over into those programs, which is great. So another thing is, what is OBS used for? It's used for recording and streaming. And yeah, that's pretty much the basic information for OBS. Let's go ahead and move into some of the other categories. One of the main things that you need to be familiar with inside of OBS is the layout of what all is going on here. So this, for example, is your current scene that is selected. And we have scenes over here down in the bottom left-hand corner. And scenes are similar to like pages on a website. And inside of those pages or scenes, we need content, and that's where sources come in. So sources kind of, you know, those could be images, webcams, display captures, video game captures, and stuff like that. And then our next part is our audio mixer. And this is where all the audio gets mixed down. And there's some advanced settings that we'll look at in a little bit inside of there. Scene transitions, this just lets us select which transition we want to use and even lets us use our own. Check out the card on the screen to watch our video on 100 free OBS transitions that you guys can get. Costs no money whatsoever and is free to download. Super awesome that we have that. And then the last is our controls section. This allows us to, you know, start streams and end them, start recordings and end them, use a replay buffer. And you might not see that right away, but we'll check out that setting in a little bit and show you where to enable that. Get to studio mode and then into our settings, and then also exit the program. All right, so before we get into all of the different setting menus that we're going to go through and pick apart piece by piece, I want to mention profiles. Profiles are used to save settings inside of the settings menu. This is extremely useful if you need different settings for recording or streaming, or if you plan on using multiple accounts and you don't want to have to go back in and adjust, you know, to have the settings for one Twitch account, a second Twitch account, a third Twitch account, a YouTube account, all those kind of things, or if you plan on streaming or recording in different bit rates and file sizes and things like that. And this saves you tons of time. All you would do is click on profile, create new profiles, and then, like I said, you can rename them, and whatever settings you make for that profile is specific to that one. And then you can create a new profile and then do other settings inside of those. Like I said, extremely, extremely useful if you plan on doing multiple accounts or just need a use case of where you don't want to have to mess with those settings over and over again. So without further ado, let's jump into the settings. To do so, we can click on the settings right here in the bottom right hand corner, or we can go to file and then settings. Either one should work for you. And we're going to be looking at our general settings first. So most of these settings are self-explanatory. If you would prefer to change like the language or the theme, you can do so here and then automatically check for updates and stuff and open up stats and things like that. But most of these things people aren't really going to need. And they're, like I said, they're pretty self-explanatory, and you can go through here and see if any of these are applicable to anything that you want to use. For the sake of this tutorial, we're not going to go through every single one of these settings because these are pretty much, like I said, for this the third time, pretty much self-explanatory. So let's go ahead and move on to the video settings. Kind of skipping over the general settings, this right here is where I tend to start whenever I'm setting up OBS on a computer for the first time. The first thing you want to mess with is the base canvas resolution. This should be set to the resolution of the native resolution that is of your monitor. So if you have a 1080p monitor, set it to 1080p. If you got a 1440p, set it to 1440p. 4K, set it to 4K. This is just dictating or trying to pull off of what your monitor is set to. The next setting, which is the output scaled resolution, this should be set to the resolution that you either wish to record or stream at. So for example, if I wanted to stream in 720p or record in 720p, I would just click on the drop down button here, and then I would change this to 1280 by 720. If I wanted to stay at 1080p, I would just leave this at 1080p, and that's gonna go ahead and let us record a stream at 1080p. The downscale filter is the method that OBS uses to convert the output resolution. So for instance, if we change this from, you know, the monitor is set to 1080p and we wanted to change it to 720p, we can set that here. I would do some research if you guys are interested in trying to find out which downscale filter is best for you, because certain ones are better for static images and stuff on screen, say for example like a PowerPoint or a presentation, and then other ones are really good for live action moving stuff, and other ones are better for like gaming and things like that. So find out which downscale filter works best for you. And the next part, in the last part inside the video settings, is FPS values. I tend to leave it on common FPS values, and if you are streaming or recording, I like 30 or 60. If you're doing any kind of cinematic work and you need these other resolutions in here, they are already pretty much in here. I don't know of any other resolutions or frame rate people might be looking to record or stream at. Maybe if you want to go really high frame rate over 60, you could do that in here with the integer FPS value. But for everybody else, I would suggest 30 or 60, depending on which you plan on recording or streaming at. The next thing to look at is audio. When it comes to the general settings, I'd normally suggest leaving everything alone if you're not familiar with sample rate and the different types of audio channels. However, if you are experiencing some issues with the audio, the sample rate may be causing that. So look into what your devices like natively support for sample rate, but pretty much everything by default in Windows, not everything, but most everything defaults to 44.1 kilohertz. And if you have issues with it, like I said, go ahead and look at that. Channels, if you're not certain what those are, stereo is pretty typical for everybody. And I don't know really anybody who's doing surround sound inside of OBS, but it's definitely something you have the option to do. And then there's also mono, but for the most part, 44.1 and stereo works for pretty much everybody. Next up is the audio devices. The first two options are for desktop audio. This is where you would typically hear audio from. For example, like your headphones or speakers. You would set this if you wanted people to hear what you hear, for example, whenever you're streaming. The other options are for microphones or auxiliary inputs. This is for devices that you would use to typically talk to people. So for example, like a dedicated microphone or a microphone that's built into your headset, you would select those here. I'm not too certain what the meters are typically used for, so I'm not gonna act like I know what those are. And then moving down to advanced monitoring devices. Monitoring devices used for testing audio levels inside of OBS or just hearing back what is being played. And this is great if you're trying to use it to balance multiple audio channels at once. So if you had like three or four microphones inputted into OBS, this would give you a good understanding, and you could hear back of what all the audio sounds like kind of meshed together, and you could adjust those as needed. The last section in here is audio hotkeys, and you can enable push to mute and push to talk for your specific microphones. So this is a really cool feature that you can go ahead and do. And then you can even add a delay in for those push to talks or push to mutes. Moving over to the streaming settings, this is where you would go to go ahead and configure a stream. All you have to do is click on a service and then select your service from a drop-down menu. So for example, if we select something like YouTube, it's gonna ask for a stream key. Click on this right here, it'll take you directly to where you need to get your stream key from and go ahead and copy and paste it in here. I want to state that if you have a stream key, do not share it with anybody, because if they get your stream key, they can stream to your channel and it does not require signing in. So they are very, very, it's very critical to not show that to anybody. And some sites now like Twitch and I believe Mixer offer just connecting your account directly, which is pretty easy to do. You just click connect account and it would pop up a screen to go ahead and sign into your account, and then it'll give you access to start streaming to that platform. The output section is where we can adjust settings for recording and streaming. At the top, we get two options for output modes. One of those is simple and the other one is advanced. As you can see here, there are a lot more settings in advanced, and for this video, we're just gonna be sticking to the simple options to save on time and kind of make this easier for people who don't know what they're doing inside of OBS. The first section in here that we're going to be taking a look at will be the streaming section. In here we have options for the video bitrate, the encoder, and the audio bitrate. And to figure out what bitrate we need to set this to, we need to determine what resolution we're able to stream at. And there's two things that determine this. That's going to be hardware inside of your computer and the internet speed, or the internet upload speed, that is. So since I am unable to speak for everyone's hardware and their computers, we're just going to be looking at the internet speeds today. To check your internet speed, head over to a speed test website. I'm going to be running my speed test on speedtest.net to show you a setting that is actually pretty useful if you don't understand the speeds that well, because most speed test sites measure in megabits per second. However, most streaming programs like OBS use kilobits per second whenever it comes to setting bitrate, and converting from megabits to kilobits is not, you know, difficult, but speedtest.net offers an option to measure the kilobits in the first place, so we don't have to mess with all of that. As you can see here, kilobits per second or kbps. So what we will do is go ahead and pull up that website. And I've got mine up here, and I'm gonna have some of this stuff blocked out because I don't want you guys seeing my ISP's IP, obviously, or my IP from my ISP. And what we're gonna do is go ahead and click on the settings, and it will bring up an advanced menu. And then what we are gonna do is, where it says speed, we're gonna change from megabits per second to kilobits per second. And then after we have changed that, we're gonna go ahead and click go and run our speed test. All right, so after my speed test, we can see that I pulled 11,495 kilobits per second on this speed test, and we need to cross-reference that with Twitch's standards for broadcasting. And this gives us a recommended bit rate for whichever FPS that's in resolution that we plan on streaming at. So if we wanted 1080p 60 FPS, we would need a consistent at least 6,000 kilobits per second, and 1080p 30 frames per second, 4,500 kilobits per second, and then 4,500 for 720p 60 FPS. And you could see that there. So go ahead and cross-reference the speeds that you get with the resolution that your computer supports, and then also the speed as far as bit rate, what we got from our speed test, and what you would be able to pull or be able to use inside of here. So after you've determined which resolution you are capable of streaming at by, you know, the speeds from your speed test, what we will then do is take that speed and put it in here. So my internet speed was about, you know, 11,000 kilobits per second, which means I could definitely stream at 1080p 60 FPS, but I've currently have my settings set to 1080p 30 FPS. So if we go back to that website and we cross-reference that with 1080p 30 FPS, it recommends 4,500 kilobits per second. So what I will do is change this to 4,500 kilobits per second. So 4,500, and that is what I need to set my bitrate to. Once again, reference that page. It is extremely useful. Next up is the encoder. If you have a NVIDIA graphics card, then you should see hardware NVENC, and there's a possibility you see hardware NVENC new. What I would suggest is, if you have the hardware NVENC or NVENC new, go ahead and use those. Those are gonna help your computer hardware not be as bogged down from the recording and stuff of OBS. This is extremely useful if you're playing any video games or if you have a lot of processing work going on for whatever you're recording or streaming. So that's definitely something I would recommend. If you don't have those options, Software X264 is pretty good depending on what your hardware is in your computer. So just go ahead and try it if that's all you have. If you're an audio wizard and understand audio quite a bit, then adjust the bitrate as you see fit. But for most streams and most people recording, 160 is perfectly fine. Next is the recording settings. This, in my opinion, is way easier to explain and is easier to set up, specifically because you don't have to run, you know, speed tests to figure out what your bitrate needs to be and things like that. And internet speed doesn't dictate anything here because it's saving to your computer. The recording path is gonna be where your videos are saved to. So click browse and pick a place where you want your videos to be saved. Your recording quality, you know, that specifies how compressed the video file sizes are, which the more compressed they are, the worse the video quality will be, but the smaller the video size, the file size will be. So, you know, the more you go up, the larger the sizes are going to be, but the better the video is going to be. From my experience, indistinguishable quality, large file size, if you've got enough storage space, is really good because the file sizes are somewhat manageable and the quality is really, really good. If for some reason you wanted to specify what the bit rate is, if you're like, hey, my stream looks really good and I just want to record the same exact settings as my stream, you could set that here and it will pull the streaming bit rate and encoder options and things like that. The recording format is how it saves the video, the container that it saves it in. I suggest MP4 because it is just very, very widespread and is pretty much usable in any video editing program. The encoder is similar to the streaming option. If you have the option for hardware NVENC, select it. If you don't, Software X264 is fine as well. We're not gonna mess with any of the custom muxer settings, but if you are interested, click on this checkbox here to open up Replay Buffer. This allows you to set like a flashback recording similar to features on things like Xbox and PlayStation, where you can record like the last 30 seconds or last few minutes. You can set the time that you wanna record here and then how much memory you're willing to allocate to that. This next section is probably one of my favorites, and that is hotkeys. Hotkeys allow you to assign specific keys or keyboard combinations to do certain actions. So for example, if we wanted to mute our mic, we'll go down here to our microphone, and we wanted to mute it with the key combination of Shift plus F12. We can hold down Shift and then press F12, and it'll assign this value to it. And then say we want to unmute with Shift plus F12 as well. We can do that, and then we can click Apply, and then OK. And then now if I hold down Shift and F12 on my keyboard, you can see that it muted my microphone inside of this program. And if I press it again, it'll unmute it. And the really neat thing about these hotkeys is that you can assign them for a pretty much almost everything that's in here. You can set them for doing transitions, starting and stopping streams, pausing recordings, starting replay buffers, switching to scenes, muting your microphone, muting the desktop audio's microphone, or the desktop audio that is, and so much more. The advanced settings has a few things that I'd like to point out, while other things in here are a little more niche and aren't relevant to 99% of people. So I wanted to make that disclaimer before I skip over a few things in here. Starting first with process priority. This is kind of cool. It lets you essentially tell Windows how important your OBS recording or streaming is, and this can determine whether Windows allocates this more resources, you know, depending on how the process priority is set. So if you were doing something really critical and you wanted to make sure this works at all costs, you could set this to a higher priority. But for the most part, if your computer is pretty decent for what you're doing, normal should work. The next thing I would look at inside of here would be the recording. This gives you modifiers for setting file name formatting, which is really cool because this helps you not delete files on accident, because you can know exactly when you recorded them just by looking at the file type, you know, and there are just tons of other things. You can, you know, see whether the output resolution was recorded at 720p and all of these things, and you can set custom file formatting tags right here, and it is just really, really cool. Another thing that might be useful is stream delay. This can be turned on and enabled here, and then you can set a duration that you want to go ahead and delay the stream by. So if you wanted to delay your stream by 20, 30 seconds, even a minute, 2 minutes, 5, 10 minutes, you can do that. This is great if you're playing, like, say, video games and you're streaming yourself in a tournament, or if you're just playing online and you are a popular streamer or somebody that's doing pretty decent streaming and you just don't want to get stream sniped. So this is a really cool setting there. Automatically reconnect. This is pretty neat if you do have internet issues from time to time. What this will do is, after so many seconds, so say every 10 seconds, we're going to try to reconnect the stream back to whatever server you're streaming to, whether that's YouTube, Twitch, Mixer, things like that. Maximum retries. This just means we're going to try it every 10 seconds, 20 times, and then if it doesn't, then we're just going to stop. And pretty much everything else in here, like I said, is kind of niche and not relevant to most people that this tutorial is kind of being aimed at. So if you have any questions about that, maybe let me know in the comment section down below and I'll try to answer it if I can. Now we're going to talk about scenes. Scenes are really cool because it gives you a lot of options from a creative standpoint. It allows you to have different point of views. It allows you to have be right back screens, intros, outros to streams and things like that, and even just different recording options and layouts, which is really, really cool. So we can see here we've got one scene. If we want to add a scene, we click on the plus button and we can rename the scene here in real time, and we can add, I don't know how many, but we can add quite a few. So we could add as, I don't know how many, but you could add a lot. If you want to remove a scene, just highlight the scene in the list, click the negative button, and it says, are you sure you want to remove? Click yes. You can right click and add a new scene. You can right click on a scene and remove it. And then you can also change the order of scenes by using these arrow buttons here or by dragging them. Another really cool feature of scenes are scene collections. So say we had a need of where we stream to one account that is my personal Twitch account, and we have branding and everything for that set up and a bunch of scenes for that. And then say we do a charity stream every once in a while, and we stream for a charity and we have different scenes for that. Well, instead of having all of your scenes for your personal account and then scenes for like a charity account in one like collection of scenes, we can create a new collection, title that, and put all of those scenes in there. That way they are very simple to swap back and forth from, you know, those groups of scenes. Next up is sources. We're going to talk about adding them, naming them, moving them, resizing them, hiding them, locking them, cropping them, and explaining all of the different kinds of them. So I know that's a lot, but we're going to break those down slowly but surely. So we're going to add a display capture so I can show you guys what I'm talking about with those first few things that I mentioned. So we're not going to give them a name right off the bat because we're going to rename it in just a second. So display capture is going to essentially capture what all is on a monitor. So I'm going to select my left monitor. That way it's not as disorienting with that whatever effect we would call that. And what we're going to do now is resize this. So we have to select an object before we can resize it. So we can select the display capture by clicking here in sources, or if we click directly on it. Sometimes it's difficult to do that if you have other sources in front. That's why I explain it this way, so you can actually see multiple ways of doing it. To move something, all you do is click on it and drag, and you can see we're moving it around inside of the frame. We can also scale things down by grabbing on the corners and pulling them like this. So we're able to scale this down to somewhere around here. If you get somewhere, you know, something in here and you're wanting to center it, you can actually do transform controls of transform. For example, if we wanted to center to screen, we could do that, or we could just center vertically under the transform. We can rotate things inside of here using this. So that's kind of cool. So we'll reset transform, and we can see that this is actually back to the original layout. If we didn't want this to move, we could click on the lock here, and this will keep us from being able to move it. If we wanted to hide the source, we could click on the eye tool there. And then another really cool feature is if we needed to crop something, we can hold down Alt, and then instead of grabbing on the corner, which actually we can grab on the corner too, you can see that we're cropping it down like that, or we could crop in from the sides and things like that. So once again, just hold down Alt and grab one of these transform controls and drag it around, and then you can do that. And then the last thing inside of the sources that you can do to each individual source is renamed. So right click on it, and then we could call this like monitor left, or maybe left monitor sounds better. So we'll do that and then enter. All right, so now I'm gonna show you guys how to build a very, very basic scene involving quite a bit of the most common sources inside of OBS. So first thing we're going to do, and I wanna mention this is not meant to be a very pretty looking scene. This is specifically to show you guys a bunch of the different features. So I'm gonna create a color source, click okay. We're gonna select a color, and this essentially just gives us a colored canvas. We'll click okay. And we're gonna leave this as our background. We don't want this to move, so we're gonna click on the lock here. So we've got our color source, and let's go ahead and rename that. We're gonna rename that to background. And let's go ahead and click on the plus again. We wanna add something else in. We're going to add in a video capture device. So this will be like a webcam or any kind of video input. And we're gonna rename this to webcam because we're gonna use our webcam. And I don't wanna use that webcam. I actually have a better webcam, so we're gonna use this one. So we'll go ahead and do that and click on okay. And we can actually drag this around and we can resize it. So we're gonna resize this maybe to somewhere right around here. And we'll leave that alone. And we're gonna go ahead and lock that. Now we want, let's say we want a display capture. So we'll click on plus here, display capture. And we'll do this same as we did a second ago, left monitor, click okay. I'm gonna select my left monitor from the list of items I have, and then I'm gonna downscale this. And then we're gonna put this somewhere right around here. So let's kind of scale this up. That's pretty cool. And we could, so we've done color source, video capture, display capture. I'll show you guys what a, I'll lock this source really quick. I'll show you what a game capture kind of looks like for setting up. We'll click game capture and click okay. And then mode, you can specify whether it's just anything that's full screen. So most games play in full screen. If not, you can select window and then tell it which window you want it to capture. Super simple. And game capture, in my opinion, is 100% recommended if you're playing a game. It's optimized to run better for a game than a display capture. Display capture eats up a lot more resources, so that is something to keep in mind. So I'm gonna go ahead and right click and remove, and then click yes. And let's add in an image. So to do that, click on plus image, and I'm gonna just add in the OBS logo. And I'm gonna find that really quick. All right, so once I found my image, I'll just go ahead and click okay. And I've got the image in here now, and we can see that it is ginormous. So we're gonna go ahead and scale that down. And let's just go ahead and put it over here by me. So we'll go ahead and do this. And now that we've got that, we've got an image. Let's go ahead and add in some text. So we'll go to text GDI. And we'll just name this text because we're very creative today. And we're gonna tell you guys, thank you for watching. I would say please subscribe, but I feel like that's pushing it too far, guys. If you're this far and you haven't subscribed, what are you doing? Come on, guys. But yeah, so we'll go ahead and add that in there. So that's how you could add in some text. And let's look at browser sources now, and then we will look at two more things, which is really neat. So to add a browser source, you'll click the plus and then browser. And we're gonna add in a Twitch chat, which is kind of cool. So we'll click, type in Twitch chat and click okay. And some of these programs support this by default, adding in a Twitch chat, but there's a lot of different reasons why you might want a browser source. So what a browser source does is it takes a specific URL. So this URL, for example, just has this, or a website. So actually I'll show you that really quick. So if I went to twitch.tv/scopes.gg and did this, it would actually load my Twitch page. So that's kind of cool. So what I'm gonna do is go to twitch.tv/scopes.gg. And then I'm going to click on chat here, click settings, non-mod settings, and then pop out chat. And then this pop out chat pops up. I'm going to Control A, Control C to copy and paste that. And then I'm going to go back in here, right click properties, and then replace this. If I went too fast for you guys, just maybe try rewatching that again. But the whole purpose of this is you can essentially add in browser sources and stuff like Stream Elements in Streamlabs OBS utilize browser sources for like overlays and alerts and stuff like that. So it's a really good way of doing it. And if we need to resize this, we can. So let's go ahead and resize that to 400 by 600. And that's a little more manageable and kind of fits in this area. So you can see with all of that, we were able to add that in really quick. So another thing that you might want to do for some reason is group things together, and groups are pretty cool. So let's create a group and call this video devices for some reason, right? So if we wanted to, for example, we could put our webcam, which is a video device, and say our monitor together inside of a group, and we could turn them on or off at the same time, lock them together so they don't accidentally get moved, like the other stuff on the screen is able to be moved. And it just gives you some features for organizing stuff such as your sources inside of your different scenes. The last thing that we're gonna look at inside of sources is filters. Filters are actually really, really cool, and they allow you to have some more customization for the different sources inside of OBS. So if you right click, say, on a webcam or even your desktop capture, you can click on filters, and then you can add audio filters and stuff like that. So you could set a hard limiter, expand, compressor, gain, you can adjust all of that, add video delay, a bunch of really cool settings. And then you could also do color corrections and things inside of here. So for example, I could do that, and I could change the contrast, brightness, all of that stuff I can do directly here inside of OBS, which is pretty cool. You could also, like I said, do the same thing with audio as well for certain devices. And this can be applied to pretty much any source inside of OBS. When moving from scene to scene inside of OBS, we have options to set our transitions, and we can set those inside of scene transition. And you can see a direct cut looks, in my opinion, absolutely awful. And the fade isn't too bad, but it isn't the best. And we can do some really awesome custom transitions. And I've already made over 100 of them that are pre-rendered for you to download for absolutely free. Check out the video in the description down below. Can't plug that video enough. It's honestly took a lot of time to make them, but I'm super happy that I'm able to provide them to you guys for free. They also come with project files if you need a specific custom color that's not included in the pack of 20 colors. And yeah, so go ahead and check that out if you guys haven't already. And yeah, I'm gonna show you guys how to do those or add the ones that I have in that pack into OBS. So if you want to, go ahead and get those downloaded and then come back here and, you know, we'll go ahead and show you how to use them. So to get started, we're gonna click on the plus icon and then click Stinger, because that's the type of transition we're gonna be using. And I'm gonna type in circle. It's late, guys, I apologize. And so now that I've got circle selected, I typed in circle because that's the transition I'm gonna use. And then I'm gonna browse to where I have my transitions saved. And then I'm gonna click circle stinger. And I don't know why the preview is a square, but I promise it is a circle. We'll click that and then make sure time milliseconds is set to frame. And then the transition point is the 45th frame. So we'll select 45th there, and then we can click preview, and we can see there is a perfect transition of where the screen is covered up whenever it swaps from A to B, and it is good. So we'll click okay. Make sure it's selected over here under scene transitions. And now whenever we bounce from scene to scene, it is a seamless transition and it looks very professional. The next panel is the audio mixer. The audio mixer allows you to adjust the volumes of all the different audio devices that you have enabled. So for example, my desktop audio is here and I can adjust that up and down by moving the sliders. And you can also mute stuff like such as my microphone, as you can see that's moving right now, just by clicking on these microphones, and then I'll mute them out and then click it back and it'll allow the audio to start coming through. Also, if you click on the settings gear and click advanced audio properties, it brings up an advanced audio panel. And from here you can adjust the audio specifically by the audio decibel volume and adjust offset from left and right side, and then the sync offset as well. and then set up audio monitoring if you need to, and even do adjust the audio track outputs inside of the audio settings. The last thing we're going to be looking at is studio mode. That is located here in the bottom right hand corner, and studio mode allows you to preview scenes without switching to them on your recording or your live stream. This allows you to edit scenes when you are live or adjust them to queue up the next scene and just have it ready and on hand. So if you click that, you can see here on the right hand side we have program, which is what's live or being recorded currently, and preview allows you to go in and edit stuff without people watching you do it. So if you're on a stream, if you're streaming that is, and you're playing a game and you're in between matches and you want to adjust something, well, what we could do is we could go back here and people are still watching this, and I can come in and be like, you know what, I want to move my chat up, and I can move my chat up. I can go ahead and unlock stuff in here, move them around if that's what I wanted to do. And then whenever I'm done, you know, I'll lock my stuff back down if that's what I wanted to do. And then I'm like, hey, I'm wanting to go to that transition or that scene that I already set up. So what I'll do is make sure that scene's selected in the deck over here in the preview and then click transition. It'll play my transition and now it's on the program side. And then I can edit other scenes if I needed. And it's just really good from a production value of being able to kind of hide what edits you're making while you're live on stream. So, all right, guys, that's gonna be all for this video. If you enjoyed, you know what to do. Go ahead and destroy that like button, especially if you watched this far. And if you haven't already and you've watched this far, go ahead and get subscribed to the channel if you aren't already. And go ahead and check out our community Discord. It is a growing community, and we are currently over 100 people in our community Discord, and we'd love to have more of you guys there. And you know, it's a great place if you guys like freebies and things like that, because we have free transitions, we've done music for streamers, and we got so much more free stuff that we plan on giving away there as well. And it's also a place where you can promote your streams and video content and stuff like that as well. So that's gonna be all for this video. Thank you guys so much for watching. This has been Chad from How To Tech, helping you guys take your tech to the next level, and I will see you guys in the next video. Peace.